Greetings and salutations, people of Foothill. I am proud to say that we are here to present you another quarantine Foothill service. And we are just here to say hello, and we hope you're doing well.
And so welcome to the online worship experience for July the 24th and 25th. It has been an absolutely crazy week for us around here. We've got some positive COVID tests. We have some people who are sick with COVID. And because we don't have enough volunteers to staff the service, we kind of made the decision to close the campus for the next 2 weeks. So we're going to begin in-person worship experience again on August the 7th. So watch your email, and we'll give you more information as we know it. Okay?
But so, in the meantime, we want to give you the best experience we can for worship. And so we hope you connect with God through this in the way that we know you will. So we pray that for you. And we wanted to make sure that we're doing this in the most professional way possible. Just like we did in quarantine, and so we're in our shorts. So
that's very nice.
I pray that you connect with God through this, and I hope you enjoy this time of worship.
So thanks for joining us. Let's get to a couple of announcements before we dig right into worship this week. Coming up on August the 7th, it's going to be our men's breakfast. We are planning to have it at this point. We're hoping that this little COVID situation has passed and we'll be able to get back together and celebrate once again on August 7th, 8 o'clock. That'll be our men's breakfast down in Social Hall. And then on later on that day, August 7th at 2 o'clock, over at Weaver Mortuary in Beaumont, we're going to celebrate the life of Naomi Curry. And so visitation will begin at 12 and the service will begin at 2. Just watch the news about that to make sure that that's on track. But we're assuming that will be on. And we would love you to be a part of the celebration of life for Naomi Curry. Give us a call here or drop us an email at info@fbcconnect.org if you have any questions about that. And then just know that, of course, our Bible studies are on hold for right now. Wendell's Sunday morning Bible study and the Richie Sunday evening. Those are both on hold until we begin in-person services again on August the 7th. The same thing for the Thursday night Bible study. So if you have any questions, you can contact Wendell Goebel or Bill Dirks or myself about information on those Bible studies. We want you to be involved in small groups. They're important. So once we get kicked back up again, get involved with one if you aren't already. Celebrate Recovery will be on hold until August the on the 6th. So contact Terry if you have any more questions about that. Otherwise, join them on August the 6th. Our youth group will also be paused for the next week and a half while we figure things out. So just be in contact with Sarah Hutchinson if you have any questions about that. Senior luncheons will continue in the month of September, so we're going to take August off. We were going to do that anyway, so just let us know that you want to be a part of that. There will be a sign-up sheet back here in the lobby once we're able to get back to regular worship, okay? And then our Sowers Ministry will continue prayerfully in August as well. And so just stay up to date with us. Would you send us an email at info@fbcconnect.org if you're joining us today, whenever that is. And we would love to say hello. We'd love to be praying for your needs and whatever's going on in your life. And then finally, the second Saturday of every month, the host church here, New Life Christian Fellowship, does their WINGS program, Women in God's Service. And we'd like to invite you to be a part of that. It's 10 a.m. in the social hall on the second Saturday of the month. Okay, so that's a good experience for all you ladies. And speaking of experiences, I'm joined here on the stage by Mega. Mega is our mascot for our Mega Sports Camp VBS, which unfortunately at this point, Mega has been postponed. Yes, sad feelings. And so, yes, it is sad feelings, but we do want you to know that we're going to reschedule it as soon as we can. We want Mega to give you and your children the message of the gospel through sports and biblical training. And so Mega's going to keep in shape, and hopefully we'll see you in a couple of weeks, and we'll be praying for you and for the rest of the group who is going to be a part of that. Please be praying that this COVID storm would pass and we would be able to get back to regular worship as soon as possible. But in the meantime, Mega, thank you for joining us. For those of you who at home, thanks for bearing with us during this. And now, join us for a time of worship. Have your communion elements ready. And just stand in your home and enjoy us for worship.
I just want to say,
it's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
I just wanna say,
I just wanna say,
I just wanna say,
I just wanna say,
it's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
It's a beautiful day.
To be available to mercy, available to grace, available to you, Lord.
Make me what you want me to be.
To be available to serve you.
I just wanna say,
I just wanna say,
I just wanna say,
you're worthy of my praise,
Lord, 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 you set me free,
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 your love is changing me,
your love is changing me,
your love is changing me,
your love is changing me.
Available to mercy, available to grace, available to you, Lord.
Make me what you want me to be.
To be available to serve you, available to go, available to you.
I'm set free.
No more fear for me.
No more fear for me.
No more guilt for me.
No more guilt for me.
Jesus set me free.
Jesus set me free.
Jesus set me free.
Now I'm available to mercy. Available to grace. Available to you, Lord.
Make me what you want me to be.
Yeah, to be available to serve you. Available to go. Available to you, Lord. Make me what you want me to be.
Oh, yeah.
I'm set free.
The Lord reigns, He is.
in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I know when I fall back, your word will come to pass.
Never will forget.
we're back in the COVID communion time where you're at home and I'm here. I have my elements, and I don't know what you have at home this morning, but whatever, or this evening, whenever you're watching, but whatever it is that you have today, we just have to remember that these are symbols of what Jesus did for us. And I know you may not have grape juice, and that's okay. You may not have the cracker, and that's okay. But today we just celebrate what Jesus did for us by sending his son to die for us. And that remembrance is what is important for us today. The scripture says that on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. He took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Wherever you are this day, if you're taking communion with us, we're gathered together. We're not together, but we're gathered in the name of Jesus together wherever you are, whether you're by yourself or with your family or whatever the situation is for you today. This is the bread. It's a wafer that's the symbol of Jesus' blood, Jesus' body broken for us. And so in this moment, you just take the bread, and the prayer is simple. God, thank you for your son. Thank you for what he did for us. Thank you for sharing him with us, and that his body was broken for us. Thank you for this bread and for what it means to us. And then you take the bread. Verse 25 in 1 Corinthians 11 is where we find these words. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." God, thank you for the blood of Jesus shed for us. Not only that we would live, but that you would wash our sins white as snow, and that you would offer us eternal life. All of a result of your perfect plan. Thank you for your son. Thank you for his blood. Bless this time. We pray it in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Take the cup. My wife takes a lot of pictures, and I mean a ton of pictures. Pictures are really, really important to her. And when Junior was growing in her tummy, she would take a picture each and every day to document how our little boy was growing inside of her, at least from the outside view. And when he was born, let's just say I should have bought some stock in Kodak. We've had all kinds of digital cameras, and we have drive after drive and album after album full of pictures. Pictures are important. They can remind us of important moments, of crucial milestones, and of celebrations. I give her a hard time about how many pictures we have in our Amazon photo account. And truth be told, I get really scared when one of the phones goes down, because I'm afraid that I didn't back up all of the photos. And if there's ever a missed photo, we're going to be in trouble. But the reality is, I'm really glad that she's had this obsession over the years. At any time, I can go back and remember all of the blessings, all of the things that God did. I can remember the challenges that are documented through all of those pictures. Today, we're going to talk about Joshua, our hero of the week. And there really is a lot to learn from Joseph and why he was a hero. Not only was he a great leader, but he reminds us that it's important to be able to look back and tell our story. Now, they may not have had album after album of photos, but we have the Bible. So if you have your Bible at home or wherever you are today, grab it and turn to the book of Joshua. This is his story. It's the story of the period of time after Moses had died. We get to see a picture, a snapshot of the passing of the baton from one great leader to really an unproven one. So as we get started in our time today, let me just pray. God, would you bless our time as we open your word? Help us to see the heroism of your man Joshua and what we can learn from him as we look at his story. Bless our time together. We pray it in your son Jesus' name. Amen. So really, there are four things that I want you to really look at and learn from the story of Joshua's life. There's a lot to learn in the book of Joshua and all of his stories. But first, I want you to see this. Number one, be strong and courageous. The book of Joshua starts with the Lord transitioning power from Moses, who was about to die, to Joshua. And now, this isn't the first time that we're introduced to Joshua. He was actually with Moses when he goes up to meet with God, when he starts to receive the Ten Commandments and all of the guidelines. And after Moses came down the mountain and all the Israelites said that they would do what God said, Moses did something, and Joshua was watching what Moses did in that moment. Of course, Moses built an altar for worship. He gathered the sacrifice for that regular worship, but he also set up a 12-stone pillar, one for each of the tribes of Israel. That must have been a moment that was really frozen in Joshua's mind. It was a snapshot that he was always able to go back to. Joshua was a faithful aide to Moses. And he got a front row seat to all of the amazing things that God did for his people. And now comes a time of transition. So let me read to you out of the NIV, Joshua chapter 1. And we're just going to read the first part of this just to get a sense of what's happening with Joshua. This is out of the NIV, verse 1, chapter 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give them to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert of Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so will I be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Though there are those words again, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. Have you noticed how many times that the heroes of the faith, that God has had to remind them not to be afraid? How many times did God say to Joshua, be strong and courageous? 3 times is how many he said it. If I'm Joshua, I'm going, what in the world is about to happen that I need all of this courage? Am I really up to this assignment? Am I really up to it? If there's something that I relearn every single week during this series, it's that if God chooses you to be a hero, you are going to be a hero. You will be a hero. And so it was with Joshua. Are you hearing God speaking to you these past few weeks? Don't be afraid. God's got this. Maybe he's whispering to you. When are you going to learn that I've got this? In all of the chaos, in all of the mess of the world, I've got this. So many times this week, I have just felt really just completely overwhelmed with circumstances, with the problems, with all the COVID dilemmas, everything that's been going on. I confess that I didn't always heed the advice, don't be afraid. And Joshua really needed the courage. He needed it right away. It was time to cross the Jordan River, and the promised land was just within sight. And the only obstacle left, natural anyway, was this body of water. And unlike when Moses led the people of Israel through the Red Sea, there wasn't an enemy. There wasn't an enemy chasing them. But there was this really huge logistical challenge. See, at the time of year that they were going to cross the Jordan, the current of the river was just really quick. And though it's only about 90 feet across or so, or at about 3 feet deep most of the time, it was raging at that time of the year, probably about 10 feet deep. A Dr. David Moster studied the Jordan River's history extensively, and he learned that in 1854, 160 years ago or so, 170 years ago, an expert swimmer tried to swim across the Jordan River, and he simply couldn't do it. It was impossible to cross. Now, of course, obviously, there were no bridges across the Jordan River at that time, and there was no shortcut. There was no way around it. So here was the question that we have today. How do you get 1 million people across a raging river with all of their possessions, all of their stuff? Well, the answer is you let God do his thing. And he did. The story goes that God had stopped up the waters of the Jordan in the town of Adam a great distance away, and they simply walked through. Again, they walked through on dry land. Josh didn't have to strike a rock. He didn't have to raise his staff. They simply walked through it. They put their toe in the river, and they were across. It was a miracle. And when all the people had gone through, Joshua told them to do something. This is going to be Joshua chapter 4. We're going to skip to chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. This is what it says here. So Joshua called together the 12 men he had appointed from the Israelites, one from each tribe, and he said to them, "Go over before the ark, the Lord your God, the Lord, go over before the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan. Each of you is to take up a stone on his shoulder." Okay, so it's probably a bigger stone, "according to the number of tribes of the Israelites, to serve as a sign among you. In the future, when your children ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. When it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off, and these stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel forever." This is the second thing I want you to see today. Don't ever forget what God has done. Don't ever forget what God has done. There may not have been an artist. There probably wasn't an artist sitting to the side of the Jordan River and taking a snapshot picture of what was happening as they were crossing. That probably wasn't the case. And there probably wasn't a teenager with an Instagram account snapping photos to post. And there were no shots of 1 million people passing over a river on dry ground. But this was an important moment in their history. And the way he wanted them to remember it was to set up a monument. And as they set up those stones, it would always serve as a reminder. A reminder of the miracle that the Lord had provided. 8 or 9 years ago, I taught this message over at LifeSpring, even before I was on staff there. And I had gathered enough stones for each of the person in the service who was there that day. And I passed them out, and I wanted them to think of the thing. Think of that one thing that God had delivered them through, and let that little stone remind them of what God had done in each one of their lives. I know some of the people there that day, and I have heard that they still have their stones. They still have those remembrances. They still have those monuments. The passage in Joshua chapter 4 says that those stones were still there in the day of the writing of the book of Joshua. I don't know that they're still there today. They're probably not through all that's happened over the years. But the main point is that God wants us to remember what he did for us. He wants us to share the story with our children and with their children. We should never ever forget the miracles that God has done for each and every one of us. The next thing I want you to remember as we look through Joshua's life is you need to obey God even when it seems silly. All right, number 3, obey God even when it seems silly. And in our flannel graph Sunday school kind of look at the heroes, this is one of the stories that most kids remember. There have been songs written about it. Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho. This is perhaps Joshua's signature story. And that's why I wanted to sing Great is the Lord Almighty today. The retelling of the story in song of them crossing the Jordan and entering the promised land, and how that story changes our lives. It's a story that always reminds us just how great our God is. And I was talking to my father-in-law this week, and we were talking about how the Jericho story is just one of those crazy stories, right? But we forget about it. It's been a long time since some of you have been in Sunday school, and we forget the stories. And for those who never went at all, there's a chance that they had never ever heard this story before. The story of Joshua and the walls of Jericho is just one of those crazy Sunday school stories, right? I mean, the reality is that to bring a wall as high and as thick and as long as the Jericho walls were required some serious firepower. They were gonna have to have something big to bring that down. Now here's how I'd read the story right out of the Zonder Kids Children's Bible if I were sitting in children's church. Okay? This is how it goes. Josh had done some recon work on the walls. And when the spies were safely home, God told Joshua, "March your army around Jericho with the priests blowing their horns. Do this for 6 days. And on the seventh day, have your army march around the city 7 times. And Joshua did exactly as God said. The priests blew their trumpets. The soldiers shouted as loud as they could. The great walls of Jericho came tumbling down. The Israelite army rushed in and took over the city." All right, come on. Really? All they had to do was shout? No siege ramps, no, just the priests blowing their trumpets. And you can't tell me that the army just marching around the walls did anything at all. That's completely unbelievable. Now, typically we look at the number 13 as unlucky, right? I mean, elevators and buildings seldom have a 13th floor button to push, and at least there's not a button in the elevator. Friday the 13th is the ultimate omen for bad things. But in this case, the number 13 was a perfect number. It was a perfect number. Once a day for 6 days. Then you add the seven times that they walked around on the seventh day, and that was their perfect number, 13. God likes numbers. And sometimes that significance is lost on us. Sometimes we think about that as the enemy's lucky number. No, that's God's number in this case. And this plan that God had must have seemed weird. I mean, there's no other way to say it. This is a weird story. It's a weird thing to do. Joshua had already been a part of military campaigns, and God had prepared him for the fact that the battle that lay ahead for him, it was gonna be intense. But God did say, "Do not be afraid." After all, I mean, God told Joshua to be strong, to be courageous. But in this case, God used a very God-like way to bring down the wall. And Joshua was obedient, even when God's plan seemed silly. But here's the thing. When was the last time that God used manpower and brute force to bring down the wall in your life? If the battle that we fight isn't against flesh and blood, but against things in the spiritual world, doesn't this story make perfect sense? I mean, sure, the story of Jericho is that it was part of God's plan to lead his people where he wanted them to go. It was what he wanted them to do. And Joshua obeyed. And God did for his people exactly what he promised. So maybe, after what we've endured these last few weeks, maybe it's time for you to shout. What is God telling you about the battle that you're fighting right now? Maybe the battle is physical, and just like Jacob, you're literally wrestling with God. Or maybe it's time to trust the walk around the wall in your life is eventually, in God's time, going to lead to a moment where he just says, "Okay, shout." And the walls around whatever problem it is for you will fall down. See, the point is, Joshua did what God told him to do, even if in his human mind it might have not made much sense. There's one last point that I want you to see from the stories of Joshua, and that is this. Be a man of your word, or be a woman of your word. The story of the walls of Jericho coming down is bookended by the story of Rahab. Rahab was a prostitute. She lived inside the walls of Jericho, and when Joshua sent out that recon team, God had them encounter her. They came to her door, and she gave them a place to hide out on the roof while the soldiers who were looking for them came. This is a great story that is really, it's worth a sermon on its own. But the key to the story is that as a result of Rahab's cooperation, And the help that she gave to the spies, they promised her that she and her family would be saved when they came back. And when the military campaign was carried out to bring down the wall. And that's exactly what happened. This is from Joshua chapter 6. And this is going to be in verse 22, just 22 and 23 right now. Joshua said to the two men who had spied out the land, "Go into the prostitute's house and bring her out and all who belong to her, in accordance with your oath to her." So the young men who had done the spying went in and brought out Rahab, her father and mother, her brothers and sisters, and all who belonged to her. They brought out her entire family and put them in a place outside the camp of Israel. So she wasn't grafted into, but she was just set outside. Here's Rahab. And Rahab is the first Canaanite to work with these Israelite conquerors, these invaders from another land. She had done a good thing. And they assured her that her family would be safe. And now Joshua has gone through and he made good on his promise. He fulfilled the oath that he had made. This passage doesn't get a whole lot of fanfare for the promises that were being kept in that moment. But that would be one of the things, that Joshua is remembered for. He took the baton from Moses and faithfully served God until the day that he died. Was he perfect? No, he wasn't perfect. But God used him to lead the next generation of Israelites into and through the promised land. They fight battles and take possession of all these things that God wanted them to have. Joshua was a hero because he followed God. Joshua was a hero because he loved and served his God. Joshua always did what God wanted him to do. And just like most of the heroes that we're looking at in this series, Joshua is really considered a type of Christ, a precursor to what Jesus would do. Joshua was for the Israelites what Jesus became for his people. Fascinating thing is that Joshua and Jesus share the same Hebrew name, Yeshua. They were both courageous and did exactly what God told them to do. Joshua led God's people into the promised land. Joshua led his people into the promised land, and Jesus gives us access as he leads us into heaven. Joshua ended up being a mighty warrior. Jesus is still our mighty warrior today, who not only forgives our sins, but through his Holy Spirit fights for us every single day. Joshua fights God's battles and he led God's people well. But like everyone else, like everybody else, Joshua's earthly story ends. He dies. But Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive forevermore. He's working for us and in us and through us, and he's even working around us. And I know in a week like this, that's difficult to see and to believe and to understand, but that's the truth. He's working in, for, through, and around us. All of these heroes that we study point us to the one that invented heroism in the first place. Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Our relationship with Joshua begins and ends with what we read here in the Old Testament. But our relationship with Jesus can last forever. It can last forever. Beginning this moment, you can have a personal relationship with the Jesus that Joshua's life pointed to. You can walk with Jesus. You can walk with the Jesus that is seated at the right hand of the Father, but the one who knows you personally and wants to be a constant part of your life. He wants to walk around the walls with you, hand in hand. And through Jesus, we can learn to be like Joshua. We can learn to be strong and courageous. We can be reminded not to ever forget what God has done for us. We can learn to obey God, even when it seems silly or even when it seems impossible in our human mind. And we can be men and women of the word as we learn to be more like Jesus every single day. Whatever it is that you're going through today, right now, whatever wall it is that you think you can't get over or around, trust me when I say to you today that God can bring down the wall. He can bring down the wall of your life. And when you let him use you, like Joshua let him use him, when you make yourself available to him, he can do big things. If if you let him. He'll help you cross the Jordan of your life. He'll help you bring down the walls. So that's the question as we close. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know the one that can bring down the walls? Do you know the one that can walk you through? That's the invitation today, that this Jesus, this Yeshua, that he would be the Lord and Savior of your life, that you would let him guide you through every situation in your life. So wherever you are today, whatever you're doing, just stop for a moment and pray these words. God, take control. God, would you bring down the walls that surround, God, the walls that separate me from fully serving you, from fully loving you. God, would your plan be complete as you bring down the walls of the situations of our lives? Thank you for this time to study Joshua, one of your heroes. Would you teach us how to be heroic, to be strong and courageous, and to follow you in all that we do? Thank you for this time in your word, God. We pray it in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Say I am. Who the Son says.
Well, on behalf of all of us here at Foothill Bible Church, we'd like to thank you for joining us on our online worship experience this week. If you were blessed by this, we would love it if you would hit the share button, or if you would tell somebody about it. If you need prayer this week, we would love you to send an email to info@fbcconnect.org. And let us know that you are watching and how we can be praying for you this week. There are a ton of things to pray for. We want this moment of COVID to go away and allow us to get back to regular worship here in the building as soon as possible, that he would restore this VBS plan that we have, and allow us to reach the lives of the children of this area. So again, thank you for joining us. Have a great week. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for these people. God, would you be with them this week? Would you care for them? Would you keep them in the hollow of your hands? And would you show them that you love them each and every day in a new way, each and every day? Thank you for our time together, and we pray it in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week. See you soon.